thing. Who has the 3x5 cards? I had 3x5 cards hand out that Linda brought. Anybody get them? Because I've only received one so far. If you have a question you'd like to see asked, please grab a 3x5 card and write on it. Do it. Mary, did you have those?
Nope.
Did you hand them all out? Oh, no, there's a pile of them right here. So. Got about 1 minute to get any more brownies that you think you need.
Maybe not 1 minute.
Or not. She's the boss.
Okay. Whenever you're ready.
I'm doing an invitation.
Welcome. We're so happy that you all are here tonight.
No, Linda, let me find you this way. There you go. Into it that way.
Sorry about that. This is new to me. We're so happy that you're all here tonight, and we're going to have an excellent debate, I'm sure. And to begin, we'd like to have an invocation by Michael Duckett, who is first vice chair of the Gwinnett County Party.
Everybody, please bow your heads. Dear Lord, thank you so much for bringing us here tonight, for allowing us to work together to build the Republican Party of Georgia. Thank you for these four men and their desire to serve, and we pray that you'll be with them as they have a very strenuous campaign. And also give us the grace and the patience tonight to have a wonderful, wonderful debate. Thank you so much, and in your son's name we respectfully pray. Amen.
Amen. Now we're going to have the pledge led by the stand, please. Sara Snyder, who's the officer in our club.
In the women's group, we don't separate God and country. So when we go through, we say one nation under God. Then
right.
We go forward. So I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you.
We have someone that is going to give a presentation about an event that's going to be held at the state convention July 1st and 2nd. Mr. Bill Reynolds, would you come forward, please?
Thank you. I don't need the microphone. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, at the state convention on Saturday morning, June 2nd, Saturday morning, June 3rd, from 9 to 9:45 a.m., we are going to have an event honoring veterans. Linda Park from Newton County is arranging this event. This is the second convention in a row that we are doing this event. I put flyers on everybody's chairs. We're bringing in an Iraqi war veteran who's going to be the keynote speaker, and he's going to talk about the impacts of PTSD on our soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines as they return from war. So we invite everyone to come to this event and help honor the veterans. Thank you very much.
All right, the big event is about to begin. We have Mr. BJ Van Gundy. That's going to be our moderator tonight. And I'm sure most of us know BJ because he's been around for a while. Let me tell you some of the things he's done. He has a long history with the party. He has served as the first vice chair of the Georgia State GOP. He served 4 years as Gwinnett County Chairman, 6 years as district chairman of two different congressional districts, 4 years as second vice chairman of the Georgia Republican Party. So he has done quite a bit for our party. He's a partner in a management consulting firm that specializes in government, process improvement, and revenue enhancement. His community service includes having served as a board chairman of the Georgia Charter School Association,
Charter School Association and a member of the First Georgia Charter School Commission. He serves as worth advocate for the Knights of Columbus, and his favorite charity is the Georgia Special Olympics. BJ is a Georgia Tech alumnus and lives in Peachtree Corners. He and his wife, Christy, have four children. It is with pleasure that I present Mr. Van Gundy.
First thing I need to do is take care of a little bit of housekeeping. David's live streaming this, right, David?
Facebook live streaming.
And I'm trying to find it on mine because those of you that are Facebook aficionados could go to his page and then share the stream on yours, I believe would work, or at least point people.
Yep.
Yeah. Spell it for me on Facebook so that I can get this done.
It's David Magdalena, M-A-G-D-A-L-E-N-A, Witham, W-I-T-H-A-M. No, it was not contrived for this event.
L-E-N-A, Witham.
W-I-T-H-A-M.
All right. Bear with me, guys. Hang on. Just a second. And I can't find
Magda. Magda? Okay, sorry. M-A-G-D-A.
L-E-N-O-A.
L-E-N-A.
Wow. Thanks for that write it out, would you?
Yeah, good.
Yeah, if you can't find it, go to my page.
Who said that?
Tori Thompson.
Hey, Tori Thompson's page. T-O-R-I, Thompson. Much easier. All right. Share now. All right, gentlemen, and or whatever you feel like saying you are today. Well, that's what's appropriate. It's not right for me to just make assumptions. You know, because if you want to do that in your opening statements or something, you do what you want. All right, we're going to have, here's what we're going to do. I'm going to have each of you guys do a 2-minute intro. You get to say anything you want to about how awesome you are. And then we'll go into some questions and answers. And if you can, try not to repeat how awesome you are in the same way you already said you were awesome. That is, don't necessarily just stick to your scripted words and the stuff you have. I've talked to a lot of people about doing this. I was asked by Peg to do this 3 weeks ago. I've talked to a lot of people about this. And I've been encouraged by most people to address the questions that you all have going into the state convention. We all talk to each other about this race. You know, I ran 4 years ago, I lost. But we all talk about the people running, and we talk both positively and negatively, even about the ones that we favor. But I think it'd be good for us to go ahead and get some things aired out. And so I intend to go ahead and compliment each one of these guys for what I know they're good at and what they do well. But I'm gonna ask them some tougher questions about what some of the criticisms are of them that are talked about by all of us when they're not in the room. So hopefully this will be fun, but guys, it's gonna be a little tougher than you may be planned on your way here. All right, so if we'll just start with John right here, John Watson. Oh, I could have started where the microphone was. Yes, and just so y'all know, Judy Bailey is gonna be keeping time up here, and she will let them know when their 30 seconds is starting to count down on their 2 minutes or their 1 minute, and then we'll do 1 minute answers to the questions I ask, and we'll do 30 seconds, just like with presidential debate, rebuttal time if somebody jumps on somebody. So go ahead, John, 2 minutes.
BJ, thanks for the opportunity. This is forum 2,560 that we've done, and so I can assure you that if you've got a tough question that probably I haven't gotten, and the reality is bring it, that's okay. Thank you for the opportunity to be here this evening. My name is indeed John Watson. I'm a candidate for chairman of the Georgia Republican Party. For the past 25 years, since a kid in the 1980s that lived and saw Ronald Reagan and had a bad haircut to show it, I think some of the young folks see on the internet, but nonetheless, began a career 25 years ago working on behalf of the party that I loved. I was finance director to Congressman Bob Barr in 1994, finance director for Chairman Rusty Paul at the Georgia Republican Party, so I've been an employee of the party. Best part about that process was that I met my wife Kimberly. 20 years will be December, 20 years, and 16-year and 14-year-old girls have been a wonderful experience on our behalf. Life got very, very interesting for my career when I met a middle Georgia senator by the name of Sonny at that point in time. And so I had the opportunity and was the chief political consultant to then Sonny Perdue. We obviously, along with many, many of the men and women in this room, changed Georgia history, as Mr. Galloway will tell us, and broke the 135-year drought that created a Republican majority and Republican governor. I later went on to serve as his chief of staff, had the opportunity to see him safely through re-election, and an honor of serving and working on behalf of the great state of Georgia. Last thing of opportunity from a bio standpoint, I will simply say that I had the high honor of being the campaign co-chair for David Perdue, and certainly appreciate all that he's doing, and again, men and women throughout this room that came together after a hard-fought process to get behind David, and thank you for those efforts. I'm running, ladies and gentlemen, because the party that I love and the party that you all love is in trouble. We are at a crossroads. We are at least $300,000 in debt.
I'll let you finish your sentence. Is it your turn? Okay.
That was my bad.
All right. Judy's taking phone calls. We brought in IT support. You ready?
Ready.
Michael. Welsh.
Good evening. How are y'all tonight? It's a real pleasure to be back in this area. I grew up not too far from here over in DeKalb County, where I went to high school. I was born up in North Georgia. And when I graduated from high school, I went to UGA like most everybody in my class, picked up a bachelor's degree in finance, and my lovely bride, Susie, who's with me tonight. I do have a big favor, though. Y'all need to pray for me. Our 35th wedding anniversary is the Monday after the convention, and you can imagine how much planning I've done for that. So, help me out on that. Anyway, I have four kids, two that are married and have children of their own, and then two that are still at home, a 19-year-old daughter, Grace, who was the 2016 Teenage Republican of the Year, and this summer will be interning. She flies out Wednesday, to intern for Senator David Perdue up in D.C. And then 17-year-old son, Samuel, who's my little guy, he's 6'5", and he is the current second vice chair for the Teenage Republicans. I am the state advisor for the Teenage Republicans, and I just finished a stint as the 12th district chairman, where as that chairman, we were able to knock off and muster the resources we needed to eliminate the last blue dog Democrat in the South, John Barrow, and put Rick Allen in place. So we took the last great seat there, and we were able to do that. And I'm running tonight because I have a plan, and hopefully I'll get to spend a little more time about it. It's on my push card. There are 4 points on my plan to be able to fix the issues that face the party and prepare us for the future. And I humbly and honestly wish for your vote, your support in Augusta in June. Thank you.
Well, good evening, everyone. My name is Michael McNeely, and I'm asking for your vote to become the next chair of the Georgia Republican Party. A little bit about me. I grew up in Renz, Georgia, a little rural town near Augusta, Georgia. Grew up in the home of Alec Francis McNeely, who at 9 months old adopted me, so the right to life issue is very important to me. Everything about my life has been focused on God and country. I was in the Boy Scouts and the Proud Eagle Scout, served in the Georgia Army National Guard, was a police officer for 14 years, and currently an executive with Georgia Juvenile Justice. In the party, I worked my way up through the ranks, first volunteering for the re-election campaign of Governor Sonny Perdue. went to my county, helped get Republicans elected into grow our party by doing the things that we all do, waving signs, making phone calls, and going door to door. I was vice chair, third and first vice chair in my county, served as the political director for the Georgia Young Republicans, served as the Georgia Black Republican Council chair, and now is first vice chair of the Georgia Republican Party. Everything about what we do in our party is about service, and I'm here to serve. We've got a lot that we can do. We've got a lot that's broken that must be fixed. But there's a world out there, a lot of people, a lot of families around the state that want to hear from us, and we have to be able to message our conservative principles and how they apply to people. We have to grow our party with the people that aren't with us today, but could be. If we unite as our grassroots, if we work together in all 159 counties, and I look forward to doing that with you in a new role, hopefully. But either way, I'm going to be Michael McNeely. I'm going to be a conservative. And I think that we've got a lot of great things we can do, and I look forward to that.
Hey everyone, for those of you who don't know me, I'm Alex Johnson. I'm running for chairman of the state GOP. I live in Dunwoody, Georgia, North DeKalb County, with my wife, Andrea. I've been involved in the party for a pretty long time. I first got involved in the College Republicans at Oglethorpe University way back in 2004, where I helped refound them. 2009, I got involved in the DeKalb Republican Party. 2010, ran for state senate in DeKalb against the Democrat. Was chairman of the DeKalb Young Republicans a couple times. I'm legal counsel in the DeKalb County Republican Party. And I've run for chairman of the state Republican Party two other times. Once with BJ, and then another time 2 years ago. I've always been about the idea that the party needs to be focused on the grassroots. My private job has nothing to do with politics. I'm a self-employed attorney. I'm 32 years old. I practice litigation. I do civil rights litigation, personal injury, some civil rights, and some random cases. But that's what I do. And I spend my time and devote my time regarding the Republican Party because I believe in the truth of the Republican Party's principles. I believe that the party and what we stand for, family values, pro-life, limited government, that those things are good for society. And what we need to be doing is advocating those principles to make sure they get enacted into law so people want to be involved with us. We need to be empowering the grassroots and showing them how to be involved. And I've been doing that for the past 4 years. First with Advance the GOP and the newsletters that many of you may have received that tell you about events and what's going on in politics. And about a year and a half ago, I became president of the Georgia Republican Assembly, which is a Republican group that is devoted to getting principled people into office. And like we started with about 6 members statewide, now we have about over 170 paid members. So I've been working to try to get more people involved, even when the party's been in debt and it hasn't been going too well at the state level. And I'm committed to doing that as chairman of the state Republican Party.
Now, we could end this all now and just stand around and talk if we take an option that was discussed beforehand, which is there's a bunch of dressing rooms in the back of this place because it used to be a clothing store. And we thought about there's more than 4 of them, but we could put each one of these guys and then just come back next week and see what happens. But instead, we're going to do questions. All right, guys, what's your favorite Abba song? Wait, not that one. Jason Thompson. I think Jason Thompson submitted that one. Abba song. All right, let's do some questions that will help go forward with other questions. What is the greatest issue facing the Georgia GOP in the upcoming years? Greatest issue, the singular greatest issue. And how do your experiences holding different offices within the GOP and on campaigns prepare you for this role? And we'll start with Michael Welsh.
Well, there's several issues that are in front of the party, but they all tend to relate to the fact that we do not have a clear vision that everybody understands. Because you'll start to say, well, it's money, but it's not money, because money will flow when people feel they can invest in the organization and the organization is doing what they expect to with that money. And you'll say it's management, and that's true. And that's a function of who's running the party and the leadership of that, because we've had good leaders and we've had ineffective leaders. I just finished a really good book about that. But as a county party officer and a district officer, you can see the leadership that I brought to the table in defeating Barrow and being able to pull all the disparate groups together, similar to what we see at the state level, and making sure that we focused on the one thing that was most important, and that was taking John Barrow out of that race and electing Rick Allen, which we were able to do.
Thank you, Mike.
Thank you, Michael. And just to make it easy on me, Michael McNeely next.
Yeah, as was mentioned, we have a lot of issues we've got to face, but I think one of the most important issues is the uniting of the grassroots. If we're united, we can do a lot of great things. And we saw with Donald Trump being elected, how people united across the country from all types of demographics, all types of backgrounds, because he was willing to stand on the principles in which he believes, that we believe. And he was able to do it without shame, without being embarrassed, without holding back. And people responded to that. He spoke very plainly to what we in our party believe and how that applies to men and women all across our state and all across our country. So a unification of the grassroots in all 159 counties will be the strongest foundation in which we can then grow and do all the things that we need to do.
Go ahead, Don.
The greatest issue facing our party is infrastructure. And when I say infrastructure, I mean, look at the numbers. We had over 2 million people in the state of Georgia vote for Donald Trump in this last presidential election, and less than 1% of those people are actively involved in the state Republican Party. That needs to change and be improved. In early 2016, I was going to COB for Trump volunteer events, trying to just bring people into the party. Same thing going to some cruise events. Number of party people that were there in the local area trying to bring them into the state GOP and tie them in, none. That was scary, and if we aren't even doing those simple things of bringing in people who are actively wanting to make a difference in politics, and these are groups from 70 to 120 people that they didn't hear from anyone except me going and talking to them about how to be involved in the party and in the process, that's an issue. So we really need infrastructure around the state so that when someone runs Republican, they can easily get elected. And we need to increase those numbers, and we do it by having a product and people out there on the field to get them involved. And then we can raise money and do everything else from that.
Mr. Watson.
The greatest challenge is also our greatest opportunity. Georgia is changing fundamentally and in fundamental ways throughout our state. We have a growing population, and God bless a state that more people want to come and be in. However, that will dictate that we have a Georgia Republican Party that has the capacity to adapt to those changes without losing on our principles, without changing our principles, but being flexible enough and adaptive enough to advertise, promote, market, and yes, fundraise in this new environment. We only need to look at what is going on in this county and in Cobb County. Cobb will be majority-minority in 4 years. Gwinnett County is today. Our opportunity is, as the Marine Corps motto says, improvise, adapt, and overcome on the way to continued Republican success.
All right. And if any of y'all that still have 3x5 cards out there, go ahead and pass them up or hold them up and somebody will come by and pick them up. I don't know. Somebody. Okay. And now, since each of you are looking to be the head grassroots guy that's in charge, the question that's come up is it was asking about how you see the Republican grassroots and how it should be organized, but how part of that is really, you know, how can you get more involvement from the grassroots? How can we drive, not necessarily more involvement all the way down to the grassroots, it's the state party. You know, you can't necessarily drive the individuals out there, but how can you, as a chairman, take more input from the grassroots so that it feels more like the grassroots actually has input into the state Republican Party? Committee structure, other things, meetings around the state. And Michael, we'll start with you. Yes, he already did.
Well, yes, sir. Listen, as I mentioned, we've got 159 counties around the state. And each man and woman in this party has experiences and backgrounds that can bring something to the table. There's no man or woman who's an island unto themselves. Anybody that's done anything great has not done it alone. So whoever you elect as chairman cannot do this work alone. And so one of the things we can be doing is having training around our leadership, around the delegate process, around candidate training. And make sure that it is training that we agree upon, that is fundamental to who we are as Republicans, and do it 365 days a year, and not just during election time. We have to have input, and your chairman should be coming to you in your counties, and not just when you come ask him to speak in a meeting, but coming to your strategy sessions and working with you hand in hand and going door to door for candidates in your local area. That's what, those are some of the things we have to do. Those are the things that will unite us and move us forward.
Right now, the state GOP, to a large extent, raises money and then spends it all in the general election, and then it rinses repeat year after year. The state party, if it wants to get donations and it wants to get more people involved, can't just be focused on spending money in the general election and paying people that are friends of the chairman. That's what's oftentimes happened in the past, and you can see it on the FEC website, that's the current system. You need something that people are willing to invest in, and you need an infrastructure that actually encourages people to be involved. That means the state GOP, the staff, all the committees need to be focused on providing resources to county parties on showing, here's speakers that can come to your event, here's trainings on technology, here are things you can do to help get more people involved. We need to do state party events around the state to help encourage people to get involved in the county parties. It's all about me and the entire state party serving you and funneling people in the public who currently don't know about the party into the county parties so you can lead them.
Mr. Watson.
The Georgia Republican Party is a wonderful group of 159 sometimes squibbling or squalling sons and daughters and our auxiliary groups. But the reality is, folks, we fight in a fashion because the reality is there's no leadership out of the state Republican Party. There's no binding vision that says that you as 159 county chairman or you as an auxiliary group leader care or that we care about you. It starts with little things like returning phone calls. That's not my time. I got 30 seconds left. That's somebody else's phone. But the state party must be a mechanism that by a leadership says that the executive board and the state committee are the board of directors to whomever one of us is the CEO president. And we must have a fundamental change in that relationship that indicates that it is indeed a partnership, that together we will be successful, divided we will fall, but we have to have that kind of community perspective.
You can take several approaches to leadership, and this is really a leadership issue. You can try to push a string to make something happen, or you can pull it. And that's exactly the image I want you to have of how I will handle this issue as your next chairman. I will pull you along by inspiring you to do things that you didn't ever think were possible. Because when you're inspired, you're passionate. And as a passionate person, you have something that most people don't have. You have influence over those around you. And with that influence, you will ask them to give up. You meant the 30 seconds, right? Not stop. It's okay. See, we're really trained. So with that passion and influence, you will convince folks to give up two of their most precious possessions, their time and their treasure. And in doing so, you will have the impact that we need for our county, our communities, our counties, and our state. And we'll be amazed at the transition that will come.
All right, thank you. Now, we'll, let's see. Something that's come up on quite a few of these cards, and, yeah, there's another one, is the current financial situation for the state Republican Party and the current legal situation for the state Republican Party. Alex, just a general question on where are you with your perception of how we've gotten here and how we get out of here with both the lawsuit and the financial doldrums that we find ourselves in?
All right, well, first, as an attorney, the main problem that happened is that they didn't have liability insurance, and I don't think they were really training the people very well to deal with racial discrimination complaints. That's where a lot of the legal issue came from, the monetary issue. Part of it came from overspending, and you can see it on the FEC website. But part of the issue is that we need to look at the fact that right now a lot of money is going to PACs and to campaigns, to candidates and to PACs. Why? Well, a lot of people would rather send their money to those organizations because they feel that has more of an impact. the state Republican Party, we need to be setting up a system and making sure the public knows how the party is actually helping empower people, how it's helping lives. Like, why should people want to give their money to the GOP? Because that's the solution. We can't just say money's going to magically appear, because it's not. Campaign finances cause it to go elsewhere. The way we get people to donate is thinking, why would you donate? Because you know your money's going to good use. The things that will make you think that are actually getting people involved in the party and getting Republicans elected.
All the way back down here.
Regardless of where we are or how we got here, the path forward to securing the next governor and all the elected offices in between is paved with a chairman that will be a dedicated full-time fundraiser-in-chief. As finance director of the Georgia Republican Party, I instituted an integrated finance plan that hit every component of the fundraising spectrum. We must have an adequate advertising and marketing mechanism that spans the spectrum from $5 to $250,000. We have to have a chairman of the Georgia Republican Party that is prepared to be on the phone, to be in the meetings, day in, day out, making the pitch, putting forward the process of achievement that the party can do with adequate resources, such that, again, most importantly, when we are ready in 2018, this time essentially next year, we can have $5 million at a minimum to spend on behalf of our next governor.
Well, this is the classic, do I fight the alligators or do I drain the swamp? You know, and that's where we are. We're trying to make decisions, and sometimes we make the wrong ones, both as a party and individuals. And right now, the party made very bad decisions. So what we have to do is have somebody that's used to fighting those battles, that they know just how much to put against keeping the alligators from consuming you, while at the same time, you are building the draining the swamp and building the opportunity to move forward over and over again for generations to come. You have to know how to handle that, because you have to know, having been there, what that's going to entail. You got to create a little space and then you got to build. You got to create a little space and build. My background in financial and operations management is perfectly suited to be able to execute that and provide the foundation we need going forward.
Regarding our finances, listen, it's fundamental to being a fiscal conservative, just like you do in your household. You don't spend more than you bring in. You prioritize based on your resources, and you make good decisions. When you have debt, then you have to have a plan to reduce that debt. You have to have a budget around your operations. And then you have to have a clear vision and articulate to those that would write the checks to the party about what you intend to do with those resources. It's not good enough to say that we're wanting to raise money to defeat Democrats. What specifically are we doing all across our state, from the local level through the state level, to help Republicans win, and what that means? And I think if we do those types of things, if we get beyond this racial discrimination lawsuit we have here, if we stop spending on consultants, overpaying them, and look at what we have, create that budget, and move forward as fiscal conservatives, then we start raising the money again, then we're back on track, then we're the party that we should be.
And I'm getting fact-checked, or we're getting fact-checked as some people are watching. And I just wanted to let you know, the party did have general liability. We didn't have E&O insurance, but the state party has had general liability insurance, just not errors and omissions. I have errors and omissions insurance, by the way, personally. Sue me. Just saying. They probably wouldn't like me saying that. All right, we have a race going on right now here in Georgia that would be a big test for a new state party chairman. The race, you know, the election takes place on June 20th, just around the corner. A new chairman would have right at just a little over 2 weeks to get your feet in there and start doing something. I'd be curious about, and I reworded a question here. How would you, and let's see, I'm gonna start with Michael McNeely this time, and we're gonna come this way around to you last, Alex. Come this way. I don't like everybody following the same person every single time, so we're gonna flip it around this other way. But what would be your 2-week plan? You don't get 100 days. You get 14 days. What is your two-week plan if you win the state party chairmanship? Michael McNeely.
Well, yeah, first I'm going to bring together the staff of the party, find out where they are on their assignments in helping Karen handle win in the 6th Congressional District. I'm going to meet with Karen and her team and say, what is it that you need from the Georgia Republican Party? And then we're going to move forward based on that, because one of the things that has happened in our party is there's been a breakdown in relationships between the party and its elected officials and candidates. And in a race like this, we need to go to the candidate and find out what that candidate needs and help them be successful in their race.
Thank you, Michael. Come this way this time.
Well, I'd be doing the same thing I did with knocking off John Barra. Is the very first thing you have to do is understand what's going on so far and get with the candidate, because the candidate has a plan. The candidate has a message. The candidate is the candidate, not the party. So the candidate has to have every resource, whether it's ours at the state level, whether it's from the 12th district, the 7th district, the 6th district, the 11th, or even the 1st. It doesn't matter. We're all going to pull together. We'll sit down and appeal. We'll get that done. We'll make sure it happens. We'll leverage all the resources from within the party onto the candidate and make sure that the candidate carries the banner of the party to victory.
Thank you, Michael. John?
There can be and will be no higher priority than securing the election of Karen Handel. We will do that by making certain that anyone at the Georgia Republican Party, if your function is not about promoting Karen and winning votes, then the reality is for the weeks remaining in the campaign, your job description will change and you will be knocking on doors with me and or making phone calls along with me in the process. Everything must be singular in its focus based upon that. I will reach out to the NRCC, I will reach out to the RNC, I will reach out to the candidate as I've done throughout my career, knowing what it is that a state party interfaces, how it interfaces, and the victory environment that we need to put ourselves in. Singular, daily, minute by minute focus out of the state party.
Every person involved in the state GOP would immediately be tasked and informed how to get tied in with the RNC people that are currently helping and Karen's campaign directly to make calls, knock on doors, and make sure she gets elected. But let's think about the fact that at this point, I mean, 2 weeks, again, our infrastructure needs to be improved. We should never have been in this situation that we're currently in to begin with. 3,000 people, 4,000 people out of 2 million who voted for Trump. The Democrats have a huge number of people door knocking. Why have 3 come by my house alone? We need to make sure that the state Republican Party already has tons of people around the state, thousands upon thousands, who can be touched with a text message saying how to get them involved in a race like the 6th district, so that we aren't in the situation that we're currently in, where turnout is scary because we don't have enough volunteers and enough resources to make it happen. That's what the state GOP needs to be focused on going forward, so that we aren't scrambling at the last minute.
Thank you, Alex. All right, now, before I get into those alluded to tougher questions, I'll let you all bring up some things. And this was well-worded. Thank you, Alice. Alice came up with a very well-worded question. I'm just going to read it straight out. Knowing your strengths and weaknesses, what, if you are elected as chairman, will be your greatest challenge? How will you handle it? This is that question you hate when you're doing your annual review. And, you know, somebody says, oh, what's the worst thing about you? I'm too honest. So let's start with Alex first here, and then we'll also come this way still.
Now, I think my greatest challenge is the fact that I've been pretty critical over the past 4 years about, maybe even longer, about the entrenched political industry, the people who actually make money off of politics. I've been pretty unfiltered in the concept that I don't think that it's good for those type of people to be in party leadership. I think that it's destroyed our party to some extent when people sell out their principles for their own financial gain. But I think that ultimately I can rebuild those bridges and make sure that we all work together, because ultimately all of us care about getting Republicans elected. People who make money off politics like seeing their clients win, even in Republican politics. Ultimately, I think that by having that infrastructure statewide and having results, results that actually raise the party money by being able to point to these events we do around the state and the training we'll be doing and all the different resources that we'll be providing, that's how we'll both raise money, get Republicans elected, and the people who I've criticized in the past will be pretty happy to see their people winning.
Okay, go ahead, Michael.
Well, I think the perception would be around raising money. That's been the number one issue that a lot of people have been talking about. But I think that when you have a vision, and when you have a budget and a plan, and you articulate that, and you couple the people that can write the $25,000 checks with those that write the $25 checks, then you start seeing a surge of people coming back and our coffers being filled. And if you look in the 6th Congressional District race, who was the one that won that race? It wasn't the one that raised and spent the most money, but it was a candidate that was principled and that everybody respected and knew and they voted for. So let's make sure that we have a balanced approach, that we have a big picture perspective and moving forward in all the things we need to do.
Yeah,
Mike Welsh. Well, my greatest strength, weakness is also my greatest strength, and that's the fact that almost none of y'all know who I am. And it sounds funny, but it's very true, because you don't have any preconceived notions about what I'll do as chairman. You have to accept the record that you see before you and the talk of somebody that you trust. And as a result of that, I'm not going to fight a lot of the things that we're normally fighting new chairman. That somebody out there hates your guts because of something you said, or somebody does not understand something that you've done in the past. So I think that that will show you that I am the person that can bring things together in a different new way.
My greatest challenge will be that I smile so much and all the time that it'll be hard to stop smiling. I take that from my wife, and I know Susie's here and says about the same thing about my friend. Folks, here's the greatest challenge I will have: instilling enough urgency in all of us, from fundraisers to grassroots to staff to all of us. Understand. 1 year from now, we will be early voting in the Republican primary process. We must all come together, and I must be a leader that demonstrates on a daily basis the level of urgency. Now is the time, folks, that we must be stepping forward and preparing to make certain that we retain and keep the momentum going in Georgia with the next Republican governor. That'll be my problem. It will be our problem that everything that we do is done with a daily sense of urgency.
And you all got to answer that, right? I'm still, okay, I made it, all right. I'm not messing this up yet. Mike, have you answered first?
Yes.
You have? Everybody's answered first, yes?
Yes.
Wow. They usually mess that up somehow. All right, so we're going to come back to John Watson for a first question. And just a little preface. As a Georgia GOP chair, you're going to have to take positions for the interest of the party, even if it means coming in conflict with Georgia GOP or with other GOP elected officials or candidates at times. With the recent federal court ruling reopening the 6th district voter rolls, this is an easy question, by the way, I'm just trying to scare you. With the recent federal court ruling reopening the 6th district voter rolls, how do you see the Georgia GOP party responding and ensuring that both party elected officials and our membership understand the impact this has now and in the future?
I thought you were going to have more fun than that, BJ.
Well, it's coming.
Yeah, good, absolutely great. Folks, we need to have a chairman that has the capacity to walk into a governor's office or walk into a speaker's office or walk into a lieutenant governor's office and say, to that man or woman, this is a critical priority of the Georgia Republican Party. That is not something that comes overnight. That is something that comes after years of dedication to this party, after years of building a trusting relationship, of years of doing what you say you're going to do, and allowing others to hold you accountable. If we are to have a functioning state party, we must have a relationship with the men and women that are the leaders at the state capitol. I've demonstrated throughout my career the capacity to do that. It has its pluses and its minuses, and I'm sure the questions will come later about that exact fact. But I'm running not as chairman of the Republican Policy Committee, I'm running as chairman of the Georgia Republican Party to see that the men and women that hold themselves up to the banner that is the Republican principles and secure the nominations know that in a state chairman, they have someone that can indeed quietly talk to them in moments, but we'll get it done from there.
All right, thank you.
Michael Welsh.
Well, as the GOP chairman, we got to stop playing defense. We need to go on offense. And a good leader looks forward and sees these opportunities. Look, this is straight out of their playbook. This is nothing new. Why are we caught flat-footed by this? We think because we're a red state that everything's going to work in our favor, the judges are all going to vote the way we want them to and rule the way we want. It's not going to happen, folks. We need to be on offense. We need to be in front of these issues and prepared for it so that we know when they come down, we already have everything ready. We're standing at the side, ready to execute before it happens.
We're a party of principles, and we have to stand on those principles. There are going to be times where there's some lines drawn in the sand, and we respectfully may disagree with fellow Republicans on particular issues. I took a public stand on religious liberty legislation. But the majority of the time, we will be on the same side on the issue, and we work together strategically to promote positions that our elected officials have that work for individuals and families across the state. Issues like education reform, where we had a charter school amendment that passed in a bipartisan fashion. Men and women, black, white, Asian, Hispanic, people from all across the state that understood the importance of having their children to be in the best opportunity they can in school. So working together hand in hand, but understanding that everything about our party, beginning and end, begins on those principles and ends on those principles that we say we believe as Republicans.
Now, I know the question was about voter registration and how to show the impact of that, and one thing that's happened to me was back in 2010, when I ran for state senate in DeKalb County, I was advised to not target minority voters or people who were swing voters, to only target the hard Republicans. That was in a Democratic district. At the time, I believed those elders that told me that that's the way to do it. Now I realize that is a symptom of complacency. We need to not be afraid of more voters being registered. We need to be in communities and having advertisements and having the entire state party focused on educating people on how our principles and policies are improving people's lives. For example, criminal justice reform, if you liked it or hated it, doesn't matter. Republicans passed it, and the Democrats took credit for it. They took credit for the fiscal conservative nature of it and how it kept people out of incarceration. That's wrong. That's why we end up losing. And that's why we need to have a state party that's advocating and advertising those things and showing the successes.
All right, thank you. Now, by natural succession, it would be Mike Welsh that gets the first tough question. So, you already kind of touched on it, Mike, that's why I did the, what are your own challenges? Do a self-assessment first. You have one term as a district chairman, and not a whole lot of name recognition around the state. Part of being a state chairman is going to know somewhat where some of the bodies are buried and things like that around the state, and knowing who's in charge in Rome and who's in charge in Columbus and having some kind of relationship with them. How do you intend to take on the chairmanship with no significant experience to do so?
Well, first of all, I'll do the same thing with you that I do to reporters that do that same thing. I reject your premise because I do have a lot of experience. Actually, I have a term and a half, and the first half of that.
Not hostily, though. You're just rejecting
the premise. Yeah, just rejecting the premise. Because, actually, I have a term and a half because I did actually was elected before the term, took over for Law and Sack, and that's the term that we actually beat John Barrow. So I got a trial by fire early on who, where, when, and the bodies that are buried in the 12th. And as a result of that, I've leveraged a lot of those things into the longer parts of the state. So the question is, do you need somebody that knows where the bodies are buried, or do you need somebody that can lead? I can lead.
All right, thank you. Let's see. Michael McNeely.
So we're doing individual tough
ones. Yes, it's going to be, I'm not going to do all the same, and they're going to be related to you very specifically, and this is more along the lines of what I was describing as the discussion that takes place out here about you, what's said behind your backs. And that's going to be the discussion.
Sure, go.
Roll. All right.
Roll.
So, this is what people say behind your back, Michael McNeely. You're a very nice guy and well-liked by the grassroots, okay? All right. Now that I've softened you up. You've been in second command of the state Republican Party through what many people think has been four not so good years for the state Republican Party. The party has all the state elected officials it could possibly have. Two-thirds, just about, is two people short of a two-thirds majority in the House of Representatives and the Senate, and all the elected officials you could possibly want have gained a lot of positions around the state. But money hasn't been raised, and ethical issues have been raised. And so I guess the question that's being asked is how did and what did you do to stand up to try and, as the second in command, tell first in command and try and do something to rectify the situation the party finds itself in so that we wouldn't be where we are after 4 years?
Well, what I did do, like some, is go take to social media and do a lot of complaining. I don't think that helps the party at all. I had individual conversations with our current chairman, executive director, and others, and was very candid about how I felt on any number of issues. And I had some individual conversations with some of you out in the audience. Now, could I have been more vocal around some of you so that you knew what I was saying in private to some of them? Maybe so, but the conversations were being had. Now, when you look at the role of first vice chair, look at rule 5.2, and I'm paraphrasing. The role of first vice chair is to serve in the absence of the chair or basically do what the chairman gives them to do. Not a lot of power and authority there. But we have an executive committee and we have a state committee. State committee consists of 150 members. It takes two-thirds of that membership to get rid of an officer, for example. So we're in this thing together. So if one person could have fixed all the problems, then you best believe I would have done that. But that's just not the reality. And going forward, we have to have a party that works together and not just focused on one person.
All right, Alex, you're also a nice guy. Also, we all know you're very committed to running for this position, being that this is your third time. So you also thought about it quite a bit. My own personal observation additionally is you're really good at social media and have good communication skills. You do a good job with your emails and all of those things being sent out. Now, that being said, there is some ugly stuff being put out on a website called Georgia Drains the Swamp website. It's now been, the person that's doing it is now known to not be anonymous anymore. It's been discovered who did it. It's been figured out that this person shares an IP address on this website and another website, and that person's very tightly tied to you as a good friend of yours and supporter of yours. And I just want to know, what is your position on that website? We all know what I'm talking about, right? All four of you gentlemen know the Drain the Georgia Swamp website. It seems like the website is pretty much hit your three opponents, but hasn't touched you, which also would lend credence to some people believing it's tied to you. What is your statement on that website, and will you publicly denounce it and do what you can to get it removed as soon as possible? It just, even if you say you're not tied to it.
Well, I'm not tied to the Drain the Swamp website. I mean, as many of you followed the advance of GOP messages, no. I mean, I have absolutely no problem calling out things publicly. So no, I don't have anything to do with said website, and that's it. Regarding condemning it, I mean, if anything on there is inaccurate, I'll gladly condemn any inaccurate facts that come out. I mean, I'm not an expert. I'm not that familiar with the website enough to know what's on there. So that's where I look at it there, but any information that's factually untrue, I'll gladly condemn anything, because I think everyone deserves to know the truth, including about whoever's running the website.
Okay. John.
Yes, sir.
John, I really like you. You want to have lunch tomorrow? Yeah. No, that wasn't it. That was not a question. Just kidding. All right. Your perceived strength is fundraising. And
I say perceived, because you did work on gubernatorial campaign. It's believed that you'd be able to do the same with the state Republican Party. But the question for you, sir, is, I'm going to soften the way I would say, but where have you been? You know, what have you been doing? You know of the grassroots. You worked for the Georgia Republican Party back in the 90s as finance director. Is that correct? Okay, as an employee, that's how you and I know each other. Most of the people here only know you from the last, I don't know, few months also. I've been doing this 25 years, and I remember working at the state party. When was it, 94, 5,
95, 3? 97.
Okay, under Rusty Paul. Where you been, man? And why are we all of a sudden coming to the state Republican Party chairmanship now?
Sure, I'll first take note that BJ didn't say I was a nice guy, so thanks, man.
You're a nice guy. And you know what? Mike Welsh is a nice guy, too.
I agree with that. Ladies and gentlemen, my path and involvement in the Georgia Republican community is indeed 25 years in standing. I have taken a different path in my career, and I'm indeed a different kind of candidate. I don't take anything away from the gentlemen that are at this table in terms of their involvement at the precinct, local, county, or district level. But I also don't think that should take anything away from my 25-year career of running, winning, and engagement in the Republican Party process that also, indeed, BJ, is partnering with grassroots. There is no successful campaign that could be won and waged in this state. Dave Baker knows darn well when he got elected statewide, he would not have done so were it not for active involvement of a campaign that was waged at the grassroots level. And so my involvement has been that amount.
All right, thank you. All right, now, I've got one more of those kind of questions, guys. So, for each of you. So, hold on to your chairs. Who wants to go first and get it out of the way? How about we just do that? Look, you went first last time, got out of the way. Okay, he's the first one to volunteer. We'll go back to Mike Welsh.
Mike, he's keep the order.
Okay, yeah, because I do get confused. All right, Mike Welsh. Your fundraising plan puts a lot of burden upon the grassroots themselves to raise money. You talk of a river trip to raise money, some golf, and some other events that are kind of heavy on the grassroots to raise money. And while it sounds very nice, the events, it's primarily based on getting money either from the grassroots or for them to support you in raising it. And from my personal observation, this hasn't been all that successful in the past, I'll be honest with you. When the grassroots is relied upon, it's not really all that successful. So if you could please tell, and I believe you have a total raised of $810,000 that you intend on that. And I'm sure you have other ideas and such. That was kind of your quick plan, right? First 100 days. Please tell us how you plan to raise the $3 to $5 million you need to make the party successful.
No problem. Look, when you're in the business world, the first thing you have to do is get money to raise money. Nobody gives you money at the big levels if you haven't already proved that you can get money out of the folks that live the party. And I know it doesn't sound good to say that the grassroots need to step up and answer it, but as I explained the other day, when there's pressure at equal points between the large donors and the small donors, or the grassroots that can't afford and utilize the party, and the party is for the grassroots, it's for the elected officials, there's a balance that can be struck, and when that balance is struck, then there's power through the grassroots. And when the power of the grassroots through their fundraising activities are known to the larger donors, guess what? They'll show up because they don't want to be left behind, because they won't have the ability to say no, and that's the plan.
Do I have a volunteer for a second? All right, I'm just going to keep going on with this. Let me find a question for you, Michael. No, you didn't. I need to scroll. The Georgia GOP chairmanship requires a lot of time on your part to be spent addressing issues as they arise. This includes, as they arise, can happen at 9 o'clock in the morning or 9 o'clock at night. As a state employee that will be working the same hours as your staff are working at the state party, how will you be able to address those issues as they arise?
I'm making fundraising calls now.
I'm traveling the state, been traveling the state, working with the grassroots now, traveling to Washington, D.C., meeting with Republican elected officials now, doing media requests on any campaign or the party now, and doing that with my work, managing my time well. Nothing changes if you elect me as chairman. I'll be able to do that and help our party grow.
Apparently he's very efficient with time as well. Alex? Let's see. You touched on this, but I'm going to give you another swipe at this and word it this way. You have slammed so many leaders in the party who work hard across this state. You've slammed elected officials and those we depend on funding, as well as quite a few grassroots members.
Could you please tell me who those people are?
I'm asking the questions. How am I? What means? You actually admitted yourself that you've been tough in doing that. I believe you know who they are. I don't have to tell you. How and by what means do you think you can raise the $3 to $5 million needed to run this party after burning those bridges?
I think what's critical is looking at the fact that, again, people want to be involved. That's how, through the Republican Assembly, we've gone from about 6 people to over about 170 plus paid members. People want to be involved. People want to be empowered. That's what's missing with the state GOP, is that we need to be a one-stop shop for political involvement. When people want to talk to elected officials, run for office, know how to make an impact in politics, have their voice heard on an issue, they need to know that they can go to the state GOP and go to their county GOPs and get that information and get empowered and know how to work on campaigns and to help people get elected. Because if we aren't actually doing those things, if we as a state party aren't providing that, we aren't going to raise money. The money will keep going to PACs and candidates instead of the party. That's the only way we're going to raise money, is by having a different culture where the state Republican Party is known by all Republicans in the state, and people know that as a value, and we have tens of thousands of people involved. That's how we'll raise money.
All right, thank you. And John, and what I would tell all y'all you could be thinking on right now is, I have other questions, but I'd just as soon watch y'all ask each other questions. So after this, after John, we will start with one of y'all to ask the other three candidates a question to have them answer. John, please explain how you intend to put the GOP first when, as a lobbyist, you have given money to Democrats. You mentioned you have plenty of contacts from all your lobbying. How can you assure me that when you are, and all these folks here, that when you get those contacts to donate to the GOP, that their lobbying efforts will not suddenly appear on the Georgia GOP agenda?
And report again, please, PJ. What'd you say?
It just says, how can you assure all of us that when you get those contacts to donate to the GOP, the ones with possibly issues before the legislature, that their lobbying efforts will not suddenly also appear on the Georgia GOP agenda?
It's really simple, folks. The reality is that the executive committee and the state committee of the Georgia Republican Party are my board of directors. And with any board of directors, there will be a healthy relationship whereby there's information given, received, and conversation back and forth. As a lobbyist, I register on behalf of the State Ethics Commission every single one of my clients. I believe it's high time that the chairman of the Georgia Republican Party was indeed a lobbyist and advocate on behalf of our conservative principles at the Capitol. Each and every man and woman in this room and around the state can go on the state ethics website, look at who that I lobby on behalf of. I'm happy to provide my cell phone number, and you can talk with me about what that assignment is. Fact of the matter is, I have no issue associated with anything that comes from our party communicating that to the leaders of the state, whether it helps me or not.
All right. Thank you, gentlemen. Anybody have a question they want to ask of the other three candidates? No? But you have to. It's part of this. 8:17. I got 13 minutes. No? Y'all know each other all well enough now because you've been hanging around all this time. I know you could give each other speeches. Actually, we could just have Alex do Michael's, Michael do Mike's, and have you go through it. All right, well, we won't do that then. So you're off the hook. What I'd like to do right now is just have each of y'all do a 2-minute wrap up, and we'll do it in reverse order and start with you, Alex. And do a 2-minute wrap up, and then we'll call it an evening, folks.
Well, everyone, thank you for having me here today. I think the most important thing to be looking at in the chairman's race, especially since this is politics, is looking at credibility, looking at results. If you look back, I've been saying for the past, but at least starting 4 years ago, we need to focus on the grassroots. We need to get more people involved in the party. We need more people to know how to have an impact. We need people to know, for example, that resolutions are official statements of what the party and the activists believe in. We need people to know how to run for office, how to run for party office, how to be in touch with legislators, how to actually like make an impact and make a difference in politics. Because I think that's probably why all of us have gotten involved. And we need more people to be involved that you can lead. I talked about that previously, and then when it didn't work out right for chairman, I started putting out newsletters to keep people informed and involved around the state, knowing what was going on, and to be able to have an impact. And going forward, I'll continue to do that and make sure that people and all the county chairs are in touch and best practices are shared. 2 years ago, I ran for chairman when I saw the financial situation getting bad. The past great state treasurer 2 years ago endorsed me in that race because of how bad the situation was. I stood up and ran for chairman because I care about this party and want to see it grow and be stronger. That didn't work out, but then I was approached by a good activist from South Georgia, Kay Godwin, saying, hey, maybe it'd be a good idea to be in charge of the Republican Assembly and try to grow the party now. And that's what I did. We went from about six or seven paid members to over 170 with four local chapters. I've been leading a statewide grassroots organization and growing it, getting a lot of the primary volunteers from last year involved in the party process. That's what we need to be doing around the state to make sure that we continue to grow and thrive in Georgia, is to actually be expanding and growing the grassroots in Georgia. And that's what I'm committed to do. All of my contact information on the push cards, you can see the past 4 years of what I've said on advance@gop.com, and I'd appreciate your votes in Augusta.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're at a critical point. Our state is red, but in order for it to remain red, we've got to do a lot of fundamental things. We've talked about several of them tonight. Not spending more than you bring in, being a fiscal conservative, being able to message to those donors, but also to individuals that are not with us today. When we leave that convention on June 3rd, what will we be saying to the men and women outside of the walls of that convention? Who will be able to be that visionary and that chief spokesman for this party? Who will be able to work with each of you to grow our party and to strategize into a future? Who has been with you for years, working with you at all levels of this party? When we talk about who the next chairman is going to be, we've got to look at all of the issues and not get tunnel vision on one. Because if we're going to grow and if we're going to continue to be relevant, we've got to be able to check multiple boxes. And you've got four men before you, and you've got to make that choice. I submit to you that I'm that person to work with you to do it. And I humbly ask for your support in becoming the next chairman. Not so that Michael McNeely has all the answers, but with what I bring to the table and your experience and background together, we defeat a liberal agenda on the other side of the aisle. We grow our party and we articulate a message that resonates with everyone. Thank you for your time tonight. Thank you for what you're doing in your party. God bless you.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I want to thank you for coming out tonight, because it's in rooms like this all across the country that make the difference. Because on June 3rd in Augusta, you will make a choice and you will choose the new state chairman. And by default, you will choose the direction of the party for the next 2 years. You are what the Founding Fathers hoped and dreamed of as electors, the electorate. You are educated, you are informed. Most importantly, you're engaged. Over the course of this campaign, I've laid out my plans, I've laid out my skills, my talents, my abilities for you to choose and decide and look at. What you'll find is that when I stand in front of you, or the governor, or the speaker, or the lieutenant governor, or the largest donor this state has, is the same person. There will be no surprises. There is a lot of transparency. I will be the same today, tomorrow, and the next day. To you, I promise that. Because together, we can make a difference. Together, we can move the party to a place it's never been before. You need an inspired leader, somebody that reaches you at the basis levels, somebody that makes you proud to be an American and a Republican. I am that person, I believe, today for this party and where we stand. And I humbly ask for your vote and your support June 3rd in Augusta, because together we can stand tall for Georgia and turn it red. Keep it red.
Thank you, BJ, and thank you everyone for being here this evening. I lay my head on my pillow at night and ask for forgiveness of my sins. I wake up the next day and do the best job I can as a man and a father and a husband. The reality is, after 25 years of political involvement in the party that I love, we are indeed at a crossroads. The moment that is upon us, and the moment that each of you will discern in Augusta, must be defined by the moment that we live in, our times. We are financially broke, the state party is mismanaged, and the Democrats are on the march and are trying to achieve victory and stealing from us what we've worked so hard over the past 15 years. As you look at the candidates on this dais and at this table, understand and acknowledge that we all have strengths and weaknesses. But look at us in Augusta with where we are in this moment in time. Send someone to be the chairman who has been a professional fundraiser, who has worked his career doing the hard work on behalf of our candidates, making the tough decisions in office environments and in governor's offices where governing and people come together in many times very difficult circumstances. And send a leader to the state party that takes not one single moment of on-the-job training and is prepared to take the fight to the Democrats, moment one. Thank you.
Thank you, gentlemen, and you guys aren't running out the door right away. You'd be happy to shake hands and say hi to everybody. All right, that concludes our program. Linda, did you have anything else? No, we're all good. Thank y'all for coming tonight.
That's a success. That's a rolling success.